Well, joining us now is Beth Cross, director of the Help and Emergency Response Shelters, also known as H.E.R shelters. I love that, Beth. I think that's great. Want to say they're located right here in our area, which is Hampton Roads, but there are shelters all around the country. Great to have you with us today to talk about this subject.
Thank you.
Talk a little bit, if you will, about how bad this problem is, because even from the story we just saw, so much is hidden. You know, and I think an abuser works to do that, to keep it under wraps.
Yeah, a lot can be hidden by a smiling face. And so I think what families are dealing with now is so easily swept under the rug. Mm-hmm. But I think it's important for people to understand that the violence that goes on is not just a slap or a punch. What we're looking at really is so prevalent in American homes right now. I mean, really, 3 women die every day at the hands of their abuser, at the hands of someone that loved them. I mean, that's like 1,100 women.
That's a shocking statistic.
Yeah, it is when you think about it's so completely avoidable.
You run 2 shelters for battered women, and you've had history with this for some time. Most of these women were not abused prior to the very early stages of a relationship with someone. I mean, it comes as a surprise to them, it seems, even. What are some of the red flags that a woman should look for in a relationship with someone who is an abuser?
Yeah, no one starts out dating an abuser. You know, that's just not how it works. It's a slow process of wearing down of confidence, of wearing down of support around you, isolating, gaining control over a person so that they're terrified to leave, or they feel extreme shame if they were ever to try to leave. And you can see those signs at the beginning just with simple things, jealousy, that you think they just like you that much, but really it might be leading to something else.
Maybe even wearing down your self-esteem.
Absolutely. So someone that really puts you down in public, in front of people, or even on your
privately,
own.
Yeah, sure.
Even privately, that's verbal abuse, and it does wear down at who you are. And then you start to believe it. And then you start to believe that you can't do without that person. And then you don't even realize that you've cut off friends and family to be with this person, and that they are your main support.
Yeah.
So it gets messy.
So you
quickly
have this weird fear and need to run away, and at the same time, dependency upon.
Yeah.
You're a pastor's wife, right?
I am.
And so talk about this, because it's even in the church.
Yeah. And
that would be shocking to a lot of people.
Well, just thinking how big our churches are and how many people they reach, you know it's happening. I've never done a presentation in a church that someone didn't help me put my things away and really had a story or really needed some help. And I think our churches sidestep the situation sometimes because they don't want to deal with the divorce and the messiness of it. And it's not like cancer where there's a victim and a perpetrator.
Yeah.
And I think what we need to focus on as the church is just that we are the hope of our local community and the world. And that means hope for the abuser and hope for the abused.
Yeah.
And opening our arms to say we will confront this because it's injustice, mm-hmm. and we will do it in a way that shows love.
Yeah.
Is very important.
That provides hope and a future for both parties, as you said. Talk a little bit about the fear that women feel. You know, this last testimony we just saw, you know, brutally beaten with a baseball bat and just sheer hands tearing at you. The fear of leaving is bone deep. What do you say to women who might be watching today that could be in a scenario like this?
Well, the minute they walk out the door, they're 70% more likely to get killed.
Wow.
It is all about power and control. And when that abuser has lost that control, they will sometimes go to endless efforts to gain it back. And we always say that you know your abuser best and how deep this has gotten. And so some people are afraid that they really are going to be, you know, tracked down and hurt very badly.
Children. Yeah.
Absolutely. So one thing that they can do is just realize and take inventory of how dangerous it's getting. There's a cycle to violence, to domestic violence. There's a tension building phase where you know, you're stepping on eggshells, and then there's an explosion where there's a physical or verbal or emotional abuse. And then you go through sometimes an apology or, well, I wish you didn't make me act like this. And then you see a honeymoon phase with you make up, you go on a trip, you get flowers, and it's hard to remember during that stage how bad it was.
But here's the other cycle that's so important in this. If a woman stays and she has children, the statistics on what those children are going to grow up and deal with are incredibly high, both that they might become an abuser mm-hmm. themselves or put themselves in the same scenario as the mom was in.
Yeah, even if they hate what mm-hmm. they've seen, it is their default mechanism unless we step in and say, this is not right. Yeah. This is not how relationships look and love looks. Our boys that come through the shelter are 60% likely to become an abuser. And our little girls that are running around are 90% likely 90%. To find an abusive relationship.
So you have two shelters. You're looking to open a new shelter in a new city in this area. We are in the fall, but in a short span of time, in a few weeks. What do you want women who come to the shelter to walk away from? And what do you think the goal of most shelters is for women who've been abused?
It's for sustainable life without violence, that you don't have to live like this, that God had more planned for your life than what you were living, and to get a taste of that and to keep it. And that's individual. I mean, it's different on each case. We know women that learn new skills and get a new job and are able to sustain themselves. We know women that stay in the shelter a little bit longer to get on their feet. We have to connect them with family or friends. We even know women that have gone back to their abuser. And we work with them from there on how to stay safe, how to make a safety plan, mm-hmm. how to keep your kids safe until you know that you're able to make this lasting change.
There is help out there. Mm-hmm. There is help out there. And I know that for many of you, if you have been struggling with this or ever have been and you're afraid of relationships, you know, you're not alone. I mean, there are people who can help you. And if you're in a dangerous situation, we want to encourage you to talk to someone about that. You can call the National Domestic Violence Hotline. Here's that toll-free number. It's 1-800-799-7233. Or you can visit hotline.org, and we just encourage you to do that. Beth, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Wonderful information. And, you know, Jesus came to set the captive free and to let us live life abundantly, but we have to receive, we have to reach out and grab that. So take this information today and do something positive for yourself with it.